Hello everybody. Today we'll be discussing a topic on echocardiography, that is tissue Doppler imaging. So the principles of tissue Doppler imaging is the Doppler echocardiography relies on detection of shift in the frequency of ultrasound signals reflected from moving objects. Conventional Doppler technique assess the velocity of blood flow by measuring high frequency, low amplitude signals from fast moving blood cells. In tissue Doppler imaging, the same Doppler principles are used to quantify higher amplitude, lower velocity signals from the myocardial tissue motion. So what's the technique used here? The spectral gain setting must be reduced, scale must be corrected, and myocardial area of interest must be placed in the center of the ultrasound beam. Nyquist limit should be set to 20 to 30 centimeters per second. So this is how we'll do the tissue Doppler imaging. In the conventional Doppler, the wall filters are turned off. So you need to turn wall filter off and turn down the gain for tissue Doppler imaging. Tissue Doppler imaging can be performed in pulse wave or color mode. Pulse wave tissue Doppler imaging is used to measure the peak myocardial velocities. It is well suited for measurement of long axis ventricular motion because longitudinally oriented endocardial fibers are most parallel to the ultrasound beam. The apex remains relatively stationary throughout the cardiac cycle. Mitral annular motion is a good surrogate measure of overall longitudinal LV contraction and relaxation. Pulsed wave tissue Doppler imaging has high temporal resolution but does not permit simultaneous analysis of multiple myocardial segments. So we have color tissue Doppler imaging, which is a color-coded representation of myocardial velocities superimposed on a grayscale 2D or M mode images to indicate the direction and velocity of myocardial motion. Color TDI has an advantage of increased spatial resolution and ability to view multiple structure and segment in single view. So this is a difference in pulse wave tissue Doppler imaging and color tissue Doppler imaging. Color tissue Doppler imaging measures the mean velocity, whereas the pulse wave tissue Doppler imaging will have peak velocity. So there is a difference in the number measured between the two. There are some important limitations to tissue Doppler interrogation. It measures only the vector of motion that is parallel to the direction of ultrasound beam. It's very important to keep the vector parallel. In addition, tissue Doppler imaging measures absolute velocity and is unable to discriminate passive motion from active motion. Passive motion that's related to translation or tethering, any motion that is from outside the chest cavity or from the surrounding normal myocardium. For this, the emerging technology of Doppler strain imaging will help to differentiate between true contractility and passive myocardial motion by looking at relative changes in the tissue velocity. So these are the pitfalls, the translation and tethering movement can affect the tissue Doppler imaging. So this is a two Doppler, the conventional mitral inflow Doppler picture showing first picture showing the conventional mitral inflow Doppler, and second is the mitral annular velocity tissue Doppler. So we have three waveforms, the SA, that is systolic myocardial velocity above the baseline as annular ascent towards the apex, the EA or E prime, that is early diastolic myocardial relaxation velocity below the baseline as the annulus ascends away from the apex, A small a, myocardial velocity which is associated with atrial contraction. The lowercase a is for annulus. If it's written M, that's for myocardial wall. And the superscript E prime are used to differentiate tissue Doppler velocities from the conventional mitral inflow. So what are all the clinical applications of tissue Doppler? First, assessment of LV systolic function. The systolic myocardial velocity at lateral mitral annulus is a measure of longitudinal systolic function. It correlates well with LVEF. A reduction in systolic myocardial velocity can be detected within 15 minutes of the onset of ischemia. Regional reduction in systolic myocardial velocities are correlated with regional wall motion abnormalities. Incorporation of TDI, measures of systolic function in exercise testing to assess for ischemia viability and contractile reserve, has been suggested because peak systolic myocardial velocity normally increases with dobutamine infusion and exercise and decreases with ischemia. The technical difficulties of timely acquisition of both 2D and TDI during exercise represents a major limitation of incorporating TDI in routine stress testing. Assessment of diastolic function. The traditional echography assessment of diastolic function relies on the mitral inflow Doppler patterns, which were seen in my previous slide, reflecting the pressure gradient between left atrium and LV. Transmitral velocities are directly related to the LA pressure, that's overload, and independent and inversely related to ventricular relaxation. Because mitral inflow patterns are highly sensitive to preload, the use of mitral wall inflow patterns to assess diastolic function remains limited. Tissue Doppler imaging assessment of diastolic function is less load dependent. The E prime reflects the velocity of early myocardial relaxation as the mitral annulus ascends during early rapid LV filling. Peak E prime velocity can be measured from any aspect of mitral annulus. Lateral annulus is most commonly used. Because of intrinsic differences in the myocardial fiber orientation, the septal E prime velocities are slightly lower than the lateral E prime velocities. Lateral E prime velocities can be 20 centimeters per second or higher in children and healthy young adults. In adults greater than 30 years old, a lateral E prime velocity greater than 12 is associated with normal LV diastolic function. Reduction in lateral E prime velocity to less than 8 in middle age or older adults indicate impaired LV relaxation and can assist in differentiating a normal from pseudo-normal mitral inflow pattern. Another application is estimation of LV filling pressures. So simultaneous cardiac cath and echographic studies have shown that LV filling pressures are correlated with ratio of mitral inflow E to tissue Doppler E prime wave. The E by E prime ratio, E by lateral E prime greater than 10 or E by septal E prime greater than 15 is correlated with an elevated LVL diastolic pressure. E by E prime of less than 8 is correlated with a normal LVL diastolic pressure. Another application is differentiating between constrictive and restrictive physiology. Both constrictive pericarditis and restrictive cardiomyopathy will be having an abnormal LV filling. With constrictive physiology, the pericardial constraint impedes the normal filling. In absence of myocardial disease, the E prime velocities typically remain normal. So in contrast, the myocardial abnormalities which are seen in restrictive cardiomyopathy will result in impaired relaxation and reduced E prime velocities. Another application is in early diagnosis of genetic disease. Although unexplained LV hypertrophy is typically required to diagnose HCM, the degree of hypertrophy and the age of onset is highly variable. Abnormalities of LV diastolic function, as represented by a reduction in E prime velocities, are present in individuals who have inherited a sarcomere gene mutation before the development of LV hypertrophy. So we can diagnose the disease earlier in this kind of patients. Even reduced E prime velocities are seen in early stages of Fabry's disease. Another application is in differentiation of athlete's heart from HCM. Approximately 2% of elite athletes have an abnormal degree of LV hypertrophy. Discriminating physiological hypertrophy due to intense athlete conditioning from pathological hypertrophy can be challenging. Athletes typically have a highly compliant ventricle with brisk E prime velocities, in contrast to the reduced E prime velocities of patients of HCM. Assessment of cardiac desynchrony. Identifying patients who will benefit from cardiac resynchronization therapy, which can improve the heart failure morbidity and mortality rates, have been challenging. Tissue Doppler imaging can be used to assess the relative timing of peak systolic contraction in multiple myocardial regions. The standard deviation of the time to peak contraction represents a measure of overall ventricular synchrony, and it may help to identify the potential responders to CRT therapy. Another application is in right ventricular function. Right ventricular anatomy and geometry is complex, and it has a challenge to identify the accurate assessment of right ventricular systolic function, which is an important prognostic marker. Reduced tricuspid annular velocities with tissue Doppler imaging have been documented in a variety of diseases, including post inferior myocardial infarction, chronic pulmonary hypertension, and chronic heart failure. Thank you all for your patient listening. Thank you.